lucky thing was that the American Army didn't get its first taste of battle going across the channel the way some people wanted us to. We had to go through that North African thing, which was a learning experience, and a very expensive one. Our army got to be goddamn good. But at the beginning, they were like anybody else. They weren't too good at it.
At an Allied conference in Casablanca in January 1943, Roosevelt and Churchill. Everything went well for the cameras. And President Roosevelt and British Prime Minister Winston Churchill announced they would accept nothing less than unconditional surrender from the enemy.
Slogan, unconditional surrender.
But behind the scenes, both men were concerned. The Allies were still trying to find ways to work together. The previous November, Allied troops under General Dwight Eisenhower had made coordinated landings in Morocco and Algeria without meeting much resistance. But Hitler strengthened his forces in neighboring Tunisia. Eisenhower's troops were meant to race east to engage the enemy, while British General Bernard Montgomery and his 8th Army pursued German General Erwin Rommel's Africa Corps westward from Egypt.
Tunisia, next door to Italian Libya, is at the rear of the Axis Army. It's the next objective for the American half of the Nutcracker campaign, closing in on Rommel from the west as the British smash from the east. The aim is to chase the Axis out of North Africa, threaten Italy and other Nazi-dominated territories in Europe, and open shorter supply lines to Russia. That's the meaning of the American drive to Tunis.
After 2 months of sporadic fighting, the battle for North Africa suddenly intensified. On February 14th, Rommel sent his seasoned veterans against the untested, poorly led, and ill-equipped Americans. His goal, he said, was to instill in them an inferiority complex of no mean order. And for a time, he succeeded. With the American forces was Private Charles Mann, a farmer's son from Luverne, Minnesota.
It was good, I guess, that you were afraid, but it did not interfere with what your real thinking was, because you had one idea, and that was that you was going to make it.
Rommel's forces quickly overwhelmed the Americans, whose armor proved no match for German panzers. Some soldiers called the Allied tanks Ronsons, after the cigarette lighter, for their propensity to burst instantly into flame when hit. Stuka dive bombers screamed down upon the Americans. some men held. Others panicked. Survivors fled westward across the open plain. They would not stop for 50 miles.
They didn't know what the hell they were doing. Guys never been under fire before, and when they got hit, they didn't know what to do, and they retreated. And they had terrible leadership. It was chaos, and war is always chaos.
The commander of the American troops there was a visible coward. He built a headquarters for himself in a rock chamber some 20 miles back from a line, with the argument that he could communicate better from there. So he was appalling.
After beating back two American counterattacks, the Germans poured westward through the Kasserine Pass, gateway to Algeria, threatening the Allies' main supply base at Tapessa. In 2 weeks of fighting, 6,000 Americans were lost. 45 soldiers from the little town of Red Oak, Iowa, were killed or reported missing. A third of those who lived were victims of neuropsychiatric disorders, brought on by the first experience of battle, for which they were totally unprepared. 2,400 surrendered. The Americans simply didn't know how to fight, a British commander said. And if they didn't learn quickly, they will play no useful part whatsoever in the invasion of Europe. General Eisenhower agreed. Our operations to date, he confided grimly to a friend, will be condemned in their entirety by all war college classes for the next 25 years. The correspondent Ernie Pyle was with the troops and struggled to make sense of what he'd seen.
You folks at home must be disappointed at what happened to our American troops in Tunisia. Personally, I feel that some such setback as this, tragic though it is for many Americans, for whom it is now too late, is not entirely a bad thing for us. It's all right to have a good opinion of yourself, but we Americans are so smug with our cockiness. We somehow feel that just because we're Americans, we can whip our weight in wildcats.
But I think every ground war has to begin that way, because what's going to happen to people is so unthinkable. So it's only after you've been in it a little while that you're capable of understanding what's happening well enough to do well at it. And you have to do well at it.
The Americans pulled themselves together. Airstrikes staggered the German advance. American artillery moved in to hammer German tank columns with howitzer shells. The enemy was running out of ammunition, food, gasoline, while the Allies were well supplied with everything they needed to keep fighting. Fearing a counterattack, Rommel pulled back through the Kasserine Pass. Eisenhower replaced his inept commander with a major general named George S. Patton, who would transform the beleaguered Second Corps into a determined, capable force.
It was purely a matter of Patton using different tactics to beat them suckers. That's what it amounted to. We'd done so poorly towards Rommel's forces, but next time around we'd done it right.
Now the Allies pushed forward, surrounding the German and Italian armies on Cape Bon in northern Tunisia. On May 12th, after three more months of fighting, the last Axis troops in North Africa surrendered. A quarter of a million men. The lessons the Allies had learned had come hard. 76,000 men had been lost, including Captain Richards Aldridge, a flyer from Mobile, who was reported missing, and Private Charles Mann from Luverne, who had been wounded in the neck by shrapnel.
That bled like a stuck hog. If that had been an inch higher or lower, I'd have had it.
The prolonged six-month campaign in North Africa had forced the Allies to postpone the planned invasion of France once again. From August until spring of the following year. But the Allies had proven that they could work together toward victory. And the inexperienced Americans were beginning to learn how to fight.
The most vivid change in our men is the casual and workshop manner in which they now talk about killing. They have made the psychological transition from the normal belief that taking human life is sinful over to a new professional outlook where killing is a craft. To them now, there's nothing morally wrong about killing. In fact, it is an admirable thing. So you at home need never be ashamed of our American fighters. The greatest disservice you folks at home can do for our men over here is to believe we are at last over the hump. For actually, and over here we all know it, the worst is yet to come. Ernie Pyle.